So next we have Mary Whelan, who is going to talk about finding occult carbon in forested ecosystems by tracing photosynthesis.
Okay, does this look right to everyone? All right, hi everyone, I'm Mary Whelan. I'm a newish professor at Rutgers University. I don't think last year should really count, but I'm new to the area and I come here from California. And one of the things that I have been studying for the last 10 years is a compound called carbonyl sulfide, which is a trace gas in the atmosphere, which helps us understand how much photosynthesis is happening in any ecosystem that air happens to blow through. So just to orient ourselves to the atmosphere for a minute, if we just take a deep breath. So you're exchanging gases with the atmosphere in whatever room or setting you happen to be in. So you just breathed out a little bit of CO2, but you're not just exchanging gases through your breath. You're also exchanging gases through bacteria that happens to be on your body, right? So you might have some like interesting bacteria in your belly button or between your toes that is emitting all sorts of interesting VOCs. If you've eaten an apple in the last day, you'll be exhaling a little bit of methanol. So it's not just CO2 that we're exchanging with the atmosphere. It's a bunch of other interesting compounds. And many of these compounds have information that goes with them. We can argue that photosynthesis is the beginning of the carbon cycle, which is the reason that I want to study it. It's the largest flux in the carbon cycle, and it is the way that we get carbon out of the atmosphere and into these ecosystems, right? So any carbon that is stuck in your ecosystem, unless it is somehow geologic, that is something that has been fixed by a plant at some point pretty recently. So my friend Yoichi Shiga did this interesting analysis for North America where he was looking at all of the different land surface models that we have and how much respiration and photosynthesis, GPP, gross primary production, the different models would suggest are happening over the continent. And the thing is that when we're measuring CO2, when we're measuring carbon over a big region like this, we can only see the net. We can only see what happens when you have whatever carbon is being fixed versus whatever carbon is being respired from the tree and from the soil, right? So you only see the balance in between these two. But if we look at these models to try to see what they're actually saying is happening in terms of how much carbon is actually getting fixed and how much carbon is being released, there are really big differences. So these are two LSMs. One is the LPJ model, I think the other one is CLM. But you see how they have really different pictures about how much photosynthesis is happening, even though they both match the same NEE and they match up with the observations of CO2 pretty well. That black line over here on this left panel, this is what we think is happening just based on tower measurements. So we're using eddy flux covariance, measuring CO2 and kind of measuring respiration at night and then separating that out from the net CO2 flux that we see during the day. And of course, you know, very few people are going to put their towers in less than pristine situations. So there's some biases in terms of where those carbon balances are being measured. But right, so the point is that it seems like for a lot of these models that we have, there's basically these knobs. So we have the overall CO2 that we're actually observing. And then you can just turn your photosynthesis up and then turn your respiration up to balance it out. And then your model is going to match the CO2 observations. And so trying to constrain this problem to actually figure out how much carbon is really moving through the system, that's the thing that I'm trying to get at. So yeah, it's a big problem. So we get at this with carbonyl sulfide. Sometimes I say that carbonyl sulfide is like the chubby cousin of CO2. It's another linear molecule and it fits in the same enzymes as CO2 does. So when they first started, when Graham Farquhar, guy did the Farquhar model, first started getting interested in carbonyl sulfide, he was interested in it for the fact that it's one of three gases that will interact with rubisco. So you have CO2, you have O2, and then you have this weird thing called carbonyl sulfide, right? And when they first started doing these measurements, they realized that there must have been something wrong. And it turns out that carbonyl sulfide is actually absorbed by a different enzyme called carbonic anhydrase. And carbonic anhydrase is the way that the leaf kind of shunts as much CO2 as it can manage into the leaf to get to the activation sites to start the photosynthesis process. And so carbonic anhydrase will hydrolyze CO2 to get it into solution and create this concentration gradient to get the stuff to diffuse into where it needs to go. And it just so happens that carbonyl sulfide will also interact with carbonic anhydrase. So when we look at the inside of a leaf, what's happening is carbonyl sulfide, both carbonyl sulfide and CO2 will diffuse through stomata. And since they're not that off in size, the resistance to the diffusion through the stomata is pretty close. And the resistance for the internal transfer is pretty close. And so you have two different endpoints to where these things go, right? CO2 is going to end up getting consumed by Rubisco, and carbonyl sulfide is going to end up getting hydrolyzed by carbonic anhydrase a little bit quicker. But the point is that if you look at the drawdown of carbonyl sulfide over a leaf, it's going to give you some idea about how wide your stomata are. And so, if we know the concentration of carbonyl sulfide, which is generally half a part per billion, and we know the concentration of CO2, and we have some sort of measure of the difference in carbonyl sulfide as it blows through, say, your forest, this is going to give you some information about what your leaves are doing in the aggregate. So you can do other things. You can do like spectral stuff, which will give you kind of instantaneous measurements of photosynthesis. But this is going to tell you regionally what your stomatal conductance is. And that's, I think, where the strength of the approach really lies. Okay, so when people tried this out in Harvard Forest, they found that on the site level, it does pretty well. So if you're measuring stomatal conductance using like heat transfer, the result that you get from that particular approach is pretty close to what you get from the approach measuring the flux of CO of carbonyl sulfide through your forest, which is great. This is what we expected it to have. And so I feel like we can measure photosynthesis on the leaf level. You can use some tricks in order to estimate photosynthesis on the site level. And so we want to use carbonyl sulfide on the regional level to kind of spread it out because it's we already have a kind of a handle on measuring it in one site. But if we want to say something for like New York State or, you know, like this entire airshed, this is where this information would really be useful. So if we take, NOAA has been measuring carbonyl sulfide since 2000. And so if we take some kind of averages of the flask network, we can see that carbonyl sulfide varies, this big orange line. This isn't just a trick of the scaling. This is, in an absolute sense, the amplitude of carbonyl sulfide variation over time is larger than that of CO2. And it's because CO2 has the balance going on of photosynthesis and respiration, right? And so we have this seasonal cycle of CO2 in this kind of chartreuse, which is the balance between these. And so the kind of the dip in CO2 isn't really happening at the peak of growing season because respiration is kind of dampening it a bit. But carbonyl sulfide is following just growth. So when you get the minimum of carbonyl sulfide, that's when you have the maximum growth. And this is for the regional level on the flask scale. Okay, so the issue that I've been dealing with for a while now is the fact that carbonic anhydrase, the enzyme that is destroying carbonyl sulfide, doesn't exist just in leaves. You actually have some in your lungs as a way to shuttle CO2 out. There's also carbonic anhydrase in a lot of soil organisms. And so we think that some of it is extracellular, some of it is intracellular, but anytime you want to shuttle CO2 around, carbonic anhydrase is actually kind of a really nice enzyme to do just that. And it's evolved multiple times independently. So if you just take a look at the soil is going to interact with carbonyl sulfide, whether you like it or not. So we did all of this rigmarole to try to demonstrate that if this interaction is large enough that we can correct for it so that we can do these large scale regional measurements and come out with a number that we can really stand behind. And so the approach had been to measure soil interactions had been like this. You take your soil, sometimes you sieve it because why not? And you look at the, thank you. You look at the relationship between how much carbonyl sulfide gets taken up versus temperature. And then you use that and try to back out how much carbonyl sulfide is going to be taken up for versus soil moisture. So there's two variables that are really kind of controlling how much of this trace gets exchanged. One of it, they both have to do with the fact that you have kind of shifting microbial communities under different temperatures and soil moistures, but also when you add more water, you're going to dampen the overall trace gas exchange over soil. And so there's this really beautiful, like straightforward way that a lot of people have been trying to get at how much of this gas gets exchanged from soil so that we can kind of correct it out. So we did all of this work, and then we built this empirical model. And this is the comparison of the model, which is in black, versus the field measurements, which are in various colors. So the Forest of Massachusetts, it's Harvard Forest. So we have 2 years of data there. The forest in Washington State is Wind River. If you're familiar with that, it's a really beautiful tall canopy. And you see that in all cases, essentially, there's like this huge data model mismatch. And so, you know, we had done all this work. Well, other people had done a lot of work and I just put it together, right? But we had done a lot of work and there's just this huge problem here. And so we can't with confidence say that we can describe what is happening with the soil enough to back out a good estimate of photosynthesis using carbonyl sulfide. So what are we going to do? Like, what was the problem here? But it turns out that when people were making these measurements, they scraped all the interesting stuff off the top, right? So you have this layer of litter that's on the top of most soils, and that's kind of the gateway between the soil and the atmosphere. And so this is a sample that we took a couple weeks ago at Howland Forest, which is my current field site. But just in like a 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter area, you have all of this leaf litter, you have all these twigs, you have lichen, you have mosses, you have fine woody debris, you have coarse woody debris, you have like different, you have whatever leaves you have growing in that particular forest, right? And so by scraping all of this off, we're missing a really big component of what is actually happening at these different sites. And so when we went back and analyzed what was what is happening at forests, we found two things that were unexpected. So here the black dots are from Wind River and the green dots are from Harvard Forest. And so the black dots here, if we see this is the relationship with temperature and OCS here is carbonyl sulfide flux. There's this weird thing happening, which we think has to do with the mosses. So mosses are this particularly understudied thing. And then over here, these like great deviations that we see are probably from differences in leaf litter moisture. Am I out of time? Is that what that noise was? Okay, good. Being too fast here. Okay, so what's happening here is that there are these dynamics that we know are happening that we need to get a hold on in order to really say what we're doing is appropriate and true. Now, I'd like to point out just as an important aside that even with all of these dynamics, the estimates that you can make for photosynthesis using carbonyl sulfide in many regions still has a smaller uncertainty than more typical approaches. So we still are beating the spread of the land surface models. Thank you. So carbonyl sulfide is definitely worth pursuing in the sense that you get an estimate that has less uncertainty than the more traditional approaches, but we have these dynamics that we still have left to kind of untangle. So with that, I'd like to say thank you. And I'm looking for ways that I can interact with Black Rock Forest for trying to get at the issue of litter and trace gas exchange. And yeah, that's basically it. All right, thank you very much, guys.
Great, thank you, Mary.